Can we start by you talking us through the developments which led to Chris Wilder's departure from the club?
Well, Tim, let me tell you, I've been in sport for over 35 years. I've seen up close and worked with many great coaches, World Cup winner, two World Cup finalists, and many, many great coaches. And I know that some managers are not the easiest people to deal with. Some of them have egos. Some of them create their own facts and believe it. But when you deal with them, you have to be flexible. You have sometimes to turn deaf ear or blind eye just to keep the relationship going. I learned three things. I learned number one is the most expensive thing in football is to change general manager, because what follows that usually is that you have to change the roster. And buying players is not, changing the roster usually is expensive. So if you can keep the coach or manager for a long time, that is the best thing for the club. When the coach is average, when the coach is very good, then that's more reason to try to keep him. I also learned that the club, it's always better that the club run its, the recruitment should be a club owned process. It shouldn't be left to the coach for many reasons. Coaches come and go, and then if it's not a club owned policy, as I said, it will lead to more changes. Coaches usually under pressure to perform now, where usually like the club think long term. Having said that, because of the special situation and the results that Chris delivered for the club the first 4 years before we got promoted, I knew that we had to make an exception and to go with Chris, to jump in with Chris, and not go with what I believe, what I've learned in 35 years of football. But in order to do that, I thought that I had to do things to alleviate the risk, so Chris will not leave us. I did three things. Number one, last year, I gave him a new contract, 4+1. I made him for sure the highest paid employee in club history. And that's a lot of money, because if our highest player is around 50,000 a week, Chris was more than that, substantially more than our highest salary for player. Second thing I did, I put a huge breakup cost for the contract. So if any other club came looking for Chris, they will have to pay us £50 million to get Chris released from his contract. But those two things were in his contract. But I thought that even that was not enough. I went an extra step. When I met Chris in Dubai last year in one of the international breaks, I offered him, if he stayed 5 years in the club and we stay in the Premier League, that I'll give him free shares, 1% of United World, which not only on Sheffield United, on many, all my other clubs, all my other sports assets, some of it in North America. I thought if he can make a stay 5 years in the Premier League, then he deserves it. And he will be maybe the first part owner, coach slash manager in the Premier League. So I really felt that, as I said, because we want to jump in all with Chris, that it's better that we lock Chris for a long time. Of course, this year did not start as we hoped. In December, Stephen told me that Chris started to think about resigning. I really got really worried. And I knew that a phone call, a Zoom call, will not do the trick. I had to go and sit with him. Problem is, because of COVID, so also Saudis are banned from leaving the country. So I spent 2 weeks trying every way I can to get a permission to leave the country. As soon as I got that permission, I flew to London. I drove to Sheffield. I met Chris before the Southampton game. I told Chris, listen, if we lose every game from now till the end of the season, we're not going to fire you. We need you to be our coach. Not because I'm not talking like out of emotions or anything. I'm talking because I believe that you are the best manager to bring us back to the Premier League. I told him I'm not happy with three things and a few things that some of them we can set after the season and talk about, and some of them we can talk about it now. I told him recruiting could be better. We should set after the season and talk about recruitment and how can we make it better. I told him I'm not happy sometimes after defeats how you talk to the media, especially when you lash the players. Like I gave him two examples when he said, I can't make cake out of sand. When he says that all I have is championship players, I told him this doesn't reflect good in the club image. First of all, those players finished ninth in the table last year. We have 8 or 7 internationals, and it hurts the club financially because when we're negotiating with the new sponsors, we always tell them even if we get relegated, we have good roster to bring us back. We have good team. When Chris come and says that we have championship players, it doesn't help us in any way. I thought to myself, it will be nice if I'm okay with Chris taking all the credit when we win, but at least take some responsibility when we lose. Don't under pressure of some losses go and say everything around me is rubbish. It will be nice to take some responsibility, but I thought. We talked also about the January transfer window that was just before the Southampton game. I felt good after the meeting that I gave him assurances. I made sure that I gave this assurance not only between me and him. I made an interview, I think, with one of the radio stations in Sheffield to assure the fans that we want Chris to stay with us even if we lose all the remaining games. I went back to Saudi. I felt good. I felt that the storm has passed. Then after we lost to Crystal Palace, I think it was beginning of January, Stephen called me and said that Chris wanted to resign. I had mixed feelings about, I don't want to use big words like I feel betrayed, I felt disappointed, but I felt that I felt it was my mistake because I put the club in a huge risk recruiting the way Chris want. We put over £120 million. By the way, I challenge many fans to name 5 clubs who invested net spending. The key is in net spending because Chelsea, spent £240 million, but they sold Hazard and Morata. Anyway, I thought that we recruited the way Chris wanted us to recruit. And, any new coach that come after Chris, I'll give you a small example. Look at Liverpool and Tottenham. They only have 2 forwards. We have 6 forwards in our roster. Maybe the new coach would not want 6, would want only 2 or 3. We spent around £60 million in those forwards to buy it into the club. So I thought And I didn't feel that I could talk to Chris again at that time. I was not feeling very good. So I let the vice chairman talk to Chris in 1 hour call. I think 2 or 3 days or 4 days after the Crystal Palace loss to try to see what's going on. Chris explained in 1 hour call why he wanted to resign. I can assure you there was no talk about director of football, about leak, whatever it was, roof leak or playing grounds or anything. He just said he felt that the team needed change. They needed a new voice, and these losses were like big toll on him and in the team. So anyway, I think Yusuf explained to him and the coach that if he wanted to we don't want. He was very clear with him that we don't want to fire you, but if you want to resign, we're not gonna pay you same money as we were firing you. The contract say that if we fire you, we pay you 1.5. I don't know the exact 10, but we'll pay you 15 salaries. But if you resign, we don't have to pay you 15 salaries. So then the email started between his representative and our financial guy. And we were astonished to find that he's asked for £4 million to resign, We said, no way we're going to pay you £4 million. You are the guy designing. We're not firing you. Why would you have to pay almost 1 year's salary? Anyway, it didn't. I have to admit, we thought that it's better to stall, because I thought three things could happen if we don't accept his resignation then. Number one, results could improve and he may change his mind. Number two, I wanted to give us all time to reflect, because we did not have a plan B. We were shocked that he resigned. Of course, some of us who worked in football understand like the pressures that maybe coaches like face, but some other people in the board felt that he's jumping ship, he quit on us. They had strong feelings about what he did. I thought time will make everybody calm down. So the situation like that. But I have to admit that after the second time he resigned, I still thought that Chris could be the coach to lead us back if we get relegated. I had questions in my mind, when we get promoted again, will he be the best coach to lead us in the Premier League again if he doesn't change his recruitment policy? But it always boiled out to one question. The next transfer window, say that we are relegated, and Chris wanted three or four players. Would I trust that if I brought in these three, four players and we started the championship poorly, lost three, four games, you will not resign then? I couldn't put myself where something was broken. Like, I will not say, like, yeah, maybe trust was broken, because I did not think that I count on him for a long time to stick with the club through thick and thin. I don't blame him for resigning. I'm sure the pressures of Premier League, the pressures of the worst start in the top five divisions in English history is not easy. And of course, Chris is in front of like after every defeat, he has to talk to the media. Like me or Sheffield United fans, we lose, we get upset, we get mad, but you turn the TV on, you take a walk, you do whatever. But for him, it's difficult. But if he put himself in my position, we spend millions in recruitment, and if you're not sure that the coach will be in the long time, committed to you, it doesn't make it easy.
Was there a breakdown in communication, a point of no return? I know you've outlined some of the reasons, but was recruitment and the wage structure a key factor?
The wage structure was a key factor, but in a different way. I was not happy, and I will never accuse Chris of leaking things to the media. But it tells you something, that our side of the story was never in the newspapers or in the media, because we never leaked it. Everything I'm telling you now, fans will be hearing for the first time. And I don't accuse Chris of leaking, because Chris, as I know him, he has he's a person of integrity. Maybe some people around him. But how many times did you read that we have a wage structure, which, by the way, I don't know what the wage structure is. I read sometimes it's 20,000. I read sometimes it's 30,000. But that's not true. We have players paid, I don't want to say how much we're paying players, but we have players above 40, we have players around 50. But I'll tell you a very simple example. How many players did we get in a loan from a Premier League club the past 2 years? We've got, I think, a player from Everton last year, a player from Chelsea this year. We bought many players from Premier League clubs, like Brewster from Liverpool, two players from Bournemouth, Musset last year, Ramsdale this year. All those players, when they came to us, either got paid the same salary they were paid in their original clubs, or they got a raise. None of those players are the highest paid players in our team. So tell me, if we bring players from Liverpool, Chelsea, and Everton, and they're still paying less than our players, what's the problem with our wage structure? I felt that was really a leak, just to make excuse for the poor performance we're doing.
Were you looking for Chris to become more of a head coach than a manager? No, were you asking him to take a step back from transfers?
No, we just said that, look, I mean, first of all, I have to be clear about one thing. I don't want fans to think when I'm talking about we're not happy with the recruiting. And let's name things. I mean, let's not hide anything. That I'm talking about the biggest, our biggest two signings this year, Brewsters and Ramsdale. I think those two players will be very good players, very good signings. I asked, look, Ramsdale now is already turning the corner and he's playing very well. And I think him and Brewster will be the cornerstone of the team next year and the years after. I'm not talking about those two players. I'm talking about this year, we need players to help us this season, not player to help us in the future, as the season showed. This was like some of the views that expressed to Chris and Stephen in the last transfer window, that we did not think we needed players to help us this year, not next season, because we don't have that luxury. This is number one. Number two, when we talk about recruitment, fans don't see the players we missed on, like the player where suggested by the board and we didn't sign. Some of them now for very reasonable value, some of them are very good players in the Premier League. One of them is having great season in Germany. So recruitment, I thought we should be more open about recruitment. Like we should not only limit ourselves to one market. And also we should not like, look, we as a club, we invested a lot in the club, but we don't have unlimited resources. So if you have £1 million, or 120 or whatever it is, you better get £120 million value. When I told Chris, I will not accept in the future, like say that you want Ramsdale to come with me with one option, only Ramsdale, because that put us in weak, you know, you've been close to clubs. I've been close to clubs for 35 years. No matter how everybody in the club doesn't leak things, things leak. Like the other club will know that you only have one option. It also doesn't help when sometimes Chris, like for instance with Brewster, talked about Brewster before even we signed him. That make Liverpool like, I think, and maybe Steven think, that we could have gotten him in the loan where we, if we stayed in Premier League, we'll be obliged to buy him. But when you put only one target, I want him to give me 4 or 5 targets and give me room to negotiate with, like give Steven and the club room to bring any of the 5. So I needed recruitment to change. I needed Chris to be more open-minded. He will still be, we never talked about, by the way, what do you call it, director of football. And there'll be no director of football next season or the season after. But when it comes to recruitment, it can't be my way or the highway every time, or only this players and nobody else. We need to have more options. We needed to have, because then it makes us in better negotiation position. This is all what I wanted.
So are you saying there was a lack of flexibility from Chris?
Look, I want to be very careful to criticize Chris, because he did really wonderful things to the club. And me and him, or the club falling out with him, I will never say a bad word about Chris. But I really think that, I will not say, like one fan told me, how can you spend £130 million in a team and you're still playing the team that promoted you from Championship? Like most of the games, it's the same 11 starters or 9 or 10. It's our lone player and the same team. I don't agree with that opinion. All what I am saying is, when it comes to recruiting, we have to be more flexible.
Why did you not make any signings in the January transfer window?
There are 3 reasons why didn't we make signings. Number one, Chris resigned. I think it was the 2nd of January or 3rd of January. How could I make January transfer window spend 2 or 3 million extra when I'm not sure the coach will be with me in 3 weeks or 4 weeks? This is one reason. Of course, when I met Chris in before the Southampton game, I agreed, despite that we had very poor, in my opinion at least, January transfer window last year. But it's different. Everybody can evaluate it differently. At least my evaluation that it wasn't very good January transfer window. But anyway, I said to Chris, okay, we will look at it. But three things happened, as I told you. One, he resigned after the Crystal Palace games. Two, we played six games after I met him in Sheffield, and we got 1 point out of 18. We lost five games, we drew 1 point. So I had to think also about, do we really have good chance of staying in the Premier League? I mean, because any money you spend now and in the loan, it's gone if you get relegated. Third one is maybe not very important, but sentimentally maybe it's important to me. We were talking about like players who play nine and a half or nine, like forward players. When Berger got injured, we changed the players that Chris wanted to bring to midfield, defensive midfielder. And I thought we had enough of those players. I thought, in my opinion, that our problem is we can't create enough chances. We have problem scoring. But when it changed to defensive midfielder, plus the fact that Chris resigned and we're not sure if he stays or not, I thought it was not wise to do any January transfer windows.
Would you like Chris to be still in charge at Sheffield United now? And did you make one final push to try and persuade him to stay on the weekend that it was announced he was leaving?
After all what I told you and admitting that something has broken when he resigned for the second time, because when you put your money, and money like 120 million is a lot of money for me and a lot of money for Sheffield United, you would expect the coach... You don't expect the manager to quit. I'm not blaming him for quitting or resigning. Quitting is a bad word, because I think really he felt, or at least that's what he told us and what he told the vice chairman in the 1 hour call, that the one reason, there are no reasons. He said he didn't have any offers. He did not. The only reason that he thinks that the locker room needs a new voice, that he thinks that he's burned, like he gave it all, he tried everything he can, and it's not working. So after that, like later, I think he asked to have another call with me. We arranged three calls, like 3 days, like two, we said, let's do 1 hour, like for like, say Monday, Friday, and like any other day, like Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday, or something like that. We made the first call, the board was there, it was a Zoom video call. We told Chris politely, we told him first that we want you to be our coach next year, but we told him some of the things we did not like. I thought the call went very well. I was shocked that his representative called me and said that Chris did not like the call and he doesn't want to do more calls. I said, no, he has to come to the second call. He came to the second call. He said, I don't want to talk. I will send you a letter with all the things that I don't like. And some of them really, I'm not going to comment, because I said I have like great respect for Chris. Not only respect, but gratitude. He sent us a letter, like all the things. And of course, at that time, the 2 months after he resigned the first time, all these like reasons, like leak in the roof, And for God's sake, if anybody thinks that we will spend 130 million in recruitment and we're not going to fix a roof, I don't know how much this magic roof will cost, but I'm sure it's not, or new training ground. I'm sure it's not more than 500 or 1 million. And if you believe that we're going to spend, we've spent 50 million already in buying the stadium back to the club and buying the academy, and out of this 50 million, maybe 6 or 7 million in improvements in the club. And it's ridiculous if anybody thinks that we're not going to fix the roof or training ground. But of course, you have to look at what we went through. We lost around 20 million of revenue with COVID. There was one of the short like off seasons in Premier League history. But we tried. But of course, when he sent us a letter, I really didn't feel good. And come on. We bring five, like all the board to talk to you, and the second day you say, I don't want to talk, I'll send you a letter. So I think after that, communication broke. We replied to his letter with a letter. I think Chris didn't like the tone of the letter we sent to him. And then the third time was the charm. He insisted in resigning. And I think at the time we felt that it's best for the club and for the long to part ways, because many things has broken. And although I have to admit, like me, Jan, Chris Musaad and Stephen, 3 days before we parted ways, we still had high hopes that we could fix things with Chris and he could stay. Of course, it wasn't up to us. Part of it was on Chris, that he has to like come a little to our side. But I felt that we can fix that after the season. But I think after he got our response to his letter, he was upset and he didn't want to continue anymore.
Can you provide us with some clarity over what happens next? Are you looking for a manager, a head coach? Will Paul Heckingbottom be considered? Do you have a number one target in mind? And has there been a lot of interest in the job?
First, our first priority is to get back to the Premier League. We are going, all options are open. We will make a decision soon. Like we want to watch how the team perform the last 8 or 9 games of the season. But I think we will have a very good, you have difference between when I say general manager or coach. I always use coach. Let me say coach, but I mean somebody who will be involved in recruitment, but it will not be total, we'll have to avoid, learn from the mistakes we did before.
Are you speaking to any candidates at the moment?
I can't comment on that because, first of all, we have now a coach that we have to respect and we have to see how he does with the team. And look, mathematically, we're still in it. I know that we 99% and a half, we're going to get relegated. But he goes and he wins the 9 remaining games. You think that, I don't know, maybe I'll sign him for 100 years contract if we do that.
What about the playing staff? Will they remain together next season? Will Sander Berger, for example, be sold?
Look, some of the players we have a break, like have the clause in their contracts that if they get a certain offer, they can leave. Those things, of course, we can't do anything about it. What I can assure you that our first purpose is to get back to the Premier League. And I think we have great advantage. If you look at the table now at Championship, who's leading the, it's Watford and Norwich City. And Bournemouth is not far away. They still have hope. So I think, If we keep the core team, of course, if we get an offer to sell one player, we will bring. If we don't have replacement, we'll bring replacement. It's not going to be like only selling players. If we sell any players, we'll bring some players in. But our intention is to keep the core team and get back to the Premier League, because staying in the Championship will not make us any money, and it's not the right place for a club as big as Sheffield United.
Are you as committed as ever to Sheffield United? Will you still be running the club in the long term?
If I'm in the club, I'll be committed 100%, as I've shown in the past, as I demonstrated with money, not with words, as I demonstrated renewing Chris Wilder's contract and make him one of the highest paid coaches, as I did when I offered him ownership of the group, of United World Group. I will make everything in my power to make the club successful. However, we know that sports is not exact science. I mean, you can do everything right. And by the way, I think one of the biggest reasons for our drop in results is the absence of fans. I really honestly believe, and by the way, even Chris believes that, if we didn't lose fans because of Corona, we would have not been in a relegation position right now. But, you know, things happen and you have to take it. You can't cry about it or feel sorry for yourself. You have just to work hard and try to do it again. And I think we will do it again.
Any regrets?
No, because you can't change the past. I mean, I'm sure, like, there's always regrets. But what good are they? I mean, you just, like, learn from them and try to make yourself better in the future.